Hello, good afternoon, everyone. I know I'm coming in on a day that I usually don't record, but by special request, I have Mr. Jasir Franklin today, which is AKA King Ruler. King Ruler has seen his share of tough times in his life. And he's a native of South Central Los Angeles. In 2019, his world was shaken to its core. He lost his house, his business tanked, and hate to say it, but his wife left him. So after hearing himself explain his life in a few therapy sessions, shortly thereafter, he began to realize how traumatic his experiences were versus how normalized it was in the hood environment he came from. Nowhere else will you find the level of normalization and acceptance of parenting without spiritual commitment, deadly diets, the normalization of violence, music that degrades and poisons the mind of its consumers, gang culture, high levels of avoidable deadly illnesses rates, or drug sales and usages. He would later identify the roots of his prior mindset as post-traumatic hood disorder. He now teaches, preaches, and speaks on PTHD throughout the country in an effort to change mindsets and improve the reality of hoodies everywhere, one mind at a time. And the other thing is he uses ORI as a way of leveraging the mindset and knowing that the mind is the strongest thing that we carry. So without further ado, I am going to bring the King Ruler right before you.
That was dope. Thank you.
That's what we do around here. That's how we do that. See, I take it and I shift some things around, you know. Look at that. But thank you so much for accepting the invitation to be here today, or reaching out and us collaborating to come together, because there is things that really do need to be addressed. So first off, I want to ask you about your upbringing in the hood, which made you reach back and think about this post-traumatic. Where did it come from, the post-traumatic hood disorder? Where did that come from?
Like you said in the opening, thanks for that again. It came from that one session, that therapy session that I had. It was about almost 15 years ago now. I had a therapy session, which was not court ordered. It was voluntary. I went in and started talking about my life over the course of 2 weeks or so. And as I kept listening to it, I was like, this is not normal. This is crazy. But what I laid out on the table in those sessions was the life that I had to live in South Central. Like, I mean, we've all seen the movies, right? South Central, I mean, Boys in the Hood, Men's in Society. We've seen the movies, but I actually lived it. So that whole thing, if I had 9 friends that I grew up with playing basketball and football in the street with, probably 8 or 7 of them went to jail or prison or dead. And to just lose people tragically like that, is people don't really take into account that's trauma. Like, there's certain things to this day, I don't go to certain places because of how I grew up. Where for some people it's normal. To me, I'm like, no, we don't do that where I come from. It's a booby trap to me. So the trauma is real from where I came from. I can go on and on, but I know we don't have that long on this show, but it's a lot that goes into that concept.
Don't want to unmute. I just wanted to make sure I gave you an opportunity without you hearing my background. But like, just tell me, like, what was your childhood like? Just living in fear every day, pretty much?
Pretty much. I mean, you never know. See, LA was that climate was more like, if you showed any weakness, you were the one that they preyed upon. Mm-hmm. And if once they preyed upon you, it became like a ripple effect around the neighborhood for everybody to take in and join in on the fun, right? So unless I'm a Pisces person, so I'm more like laid back naturally. So I had to switch. I had to turn the switch on and be something different that I wasn't. And because of that, if you live that life for so long, you start believing it in your mind, right? So I had to live that life for so long that even into my adult life, I was still acting a way that I'm really not deep down in order to survive where I came from.
And that's amazing that you would say that, because like my baby brother is a Pisces and he is so laid back. He ain't looking for no trouble. He ain't trying to cause no trouble. He just laid back. And it's like, you know, he in the room, it's like ain't nothing but peace, you know, when he's in the room. Mm-hmm. But to even have to change who you are just to fit in your environment, I'm pretty sure that that was like killing you on the inside. You know, I'm sure it was more of an internal battle. Like your insides was really, it was like a mind and heart thing, like a battle between your heart and your mind.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, consistently every day. But as you live it, it's kind of like if you steal something one time, you'll feel bad about it. Like I stole this. You do it again, it gets easier. You do it again, it gets easier, right? So for me, it was the same thing. The first time I did it, I can tell you a brief story of how it snapped. It was a guy in the neighborhood. I forgot his name now, but he kept.
If you don't mind, I'm going to leave you up by yourself and let you talk.
Okay.
So you could tell your story. I'll pull down. Okay.
Okay. So in the neighborhood, I was kind of like, you know, the cool cat. Like I didn't really get into too much trouble. I didn't bother nobody. And that was kind of the word. So I didn't pick up immediately on what these cats were trying to do. It took a while. And one day I was playing in my front yard with a guy, and this guy kept trying to do the same things that other guys were doing. But me and him were really friends for a while. So we had never had this issue until that day. And we were playing football and we were like, you know, running posts and routes and catching the ball. We were guarding each other and I kept beating him in the routes. So I guess he got kind of upset. So I beat him on the last one and he pushed me as I'm running full speed. He pushes me and I slide on the concrete and scrape both of my elbows up, which I still have a scar to this day. But at that moment, I just snapped. I snapped and I had to go off and just like beat that dude completely up. I didn't want to, but he just kept pushing me. And then it clicked. Like these dudes really think I'm soft. Like, this is what it is. Like, until I do this, now people understand and the word spreads around the neighborhood. Jossier got into the fight and beat up Wilson. Now people understand that I will fight back. And then the respect level kind of comes in with that. So just to have to even do that, to just be a child and play and to have fun. Because in the neighborhood, if you are a punk, you will get dealt with every time they see you. Every time. And then it spreads into school, and then it spreads into everything else. Like you get labeled and branded in that environment.
That gotta be hard though. As a child, you can't even live a child's life just because you're so busy being on guard all the time. Mm-hmm. That's so sad. That is sad. And when I think about boys in the hood, they wasn't the tough guys, you know. They just wanted to be kids. But, you know, because of their neighborhood and friends getting killed and all of that kind of stuff, that right there gotta play on your mind. You know, it has to. But I do love this post-traumatic hood disorder. So who is your target audience for this? Like, who is your target audience? Like, are you just trying to focus on the teenagers or, you know?
I mean, my goal is the youth at this point. Like, I think they need a chance to understand that you don't have to be your surroundings. Like, you don't have to become that. There's different ways to dealing with it. I've always said Biggie lied in that song where he said, either you slanging crack rock or you got a wicked jump shot. It's like we only sold the things that are destructive or entertainment for other people. That I want them to know that it's another way. But you have to turn your back on everything you've learned in that environment. You cannot take that environment with you everywhere. It's not going to fit. It's just not going to fit. Just look at Ja Morant. He's trying to be something that he's not. He's watching what he's emulating what he sees to be the popular culture. That's not really our culture. It's a bastard culture of ours. But he's emulating this thing. And now look at the trouble he's got into. It's like you can't take that everywhere. And the problem with that is if once you, as a young man or a woman, you go through this, you tend to take it into every aspect of your life. You take it into your job. You take it into your relationships. You take it into how you parent people. You take it into your community, how you just show up in the community, period. Like it's a disease that needs to be, it's a disorder that needs to be properly diagnosed and dealt with and treated gingerly. Therapy is really needed if you came out of that area.
Ooh, therapy is essential. It's very essential. And sometimes it's, especially us as African-Americans, a lot of times it's looked down upon on, you know, going to therapy. And some people say, just pray about it. But what I found when I went to therapy is that there was so much stuff that was deep rooted inside of me that needed to come out, that I needed to deal with, even emotions that I had pushed down so far. So it's so important to get therapy. So then that way you can deal with the issues at hand. So then you can start to heal, because it's a whole healing process. The healing process is something else. It really is. Because it's like, you know, like for you, it was more like a deprogramming to reprogram.
Absolutely.
Yeah. That deprogramming, you know, through the therapy.
Absolutely. Because, I mean, I look at the mind like a computer. And we write softwares every day, all day. And we write programs in our mind. So if you came from that environment, the hood, even if you're, I call them a hood refugee, right? If you're a hood refugee that moved out of the hood, moved to the burbs, got the good job, went to school, all that type of stuff. Even if you do that, like I said, it follows you. And without therapy, without being able to communicate that, I had to literally sneak across the street from my barbershop to get my, I snuck across the street from my barbershop to get the therapy. Because, you know, our community doesn't associate. I couldn't be getting my hair cut like, hey, I think I'll go to the therapist across the street. Talk to you later. Like, they wouldn't be able to understand that, right? So I was sneaking across the street to go over to do that. But at the same time, if you come from that environment and your mind is your mind is wired, like this thing is so deep. That's why I made this thing. It's so deep that your mind and your neurons that you send out every second of the day is a result of your thoughts. And your thoughts create the words that you speak. And the words that you speak create your reality. If you look at the rap music, they're just describing what that whole process program that they're playing. Only way to break that is to delete that file. And that only happens by acknowledging it and recreating a file. First, visualizing what you want your life to be like outside of this neighborhood mentality. But then start programming that every day. And that happens by therapy and talking it out and getting it out and associating that with somebody else's perspective, and particularly, hopefully, some kind of spiritual guidance.
Right. Yeah, that's big. That's really big. It's spirituality. That's big. I mean, I'm really big on that. And I'm pretty sure, like, even not only on top of the stereotype of Black people, you know, going to therapy, it's you're a man voluntarily going to therapy.
That part.
And it makes such a big difference for a man to say, I know I need help. I know I need help. And hopefully those that are watching this today, if you're a male and you know that you have a whole bunch of deep-rooted stuff on the inside of you that you need to really, truly heal from, take it from him, from the king ruler, that it is necessary. It is definitely necessary. Talk to us about the mindset, the ORI, because we kind of touched on that. But if you can go just a little bit deeper, because I know it's in there.
It's called ORI, and ORI is the mind in the spiritual aspect. It's the mind, and the mind is the epicenter of everything that happens in your life. Nothing happens without ORI. Nothing gets blessed without ORI. Nothing gets turned down without ORI. And your ORI is the, like I said, the computer system that you're operating on. Spiritually, it is the guide for every human being in their life. Your ORI stores your purpose. Your ORI stores your everything you are to be. Every gene you've taken from your mother, every gene you've taken from your father and their whole down line and lineage is stored in your ORI. And that is for you to play out in this life. Now, that gets convoluted when you have softwares that pop up on your screen, like a computer, right? It gets distractive. You get distracted by these things, and it creates and rewrites different programs that the society puts on you that's not a part of your original hardware.
Wow. Let me kind of interject right there. So the things that come in that disturbs that whole pattern, that could be a relationship. Mm-hmm. That could be people. Because sometimes we get into these relationships with people that just don't line up with where we're supposed to be going. So that distracts that whole hardware thing. That now it's like you got to deter from that, because now you focused on this, which is really not good. Then you got to get deprogrammed from them when you get rid of them. Exactly. To get back in alignment. Am I exactly on the right track?
Exactly.
Because like, my mind go 50,000 directions and mm-hmm. I be hearing all kinds of stuff and be like, yep, that part right there. Mm-hmm. But I understand, like, you know, your mind. And see, let me say this. I think about everybody's ability to be successful. Everybody has the same opportunities that other people do. You have some people that was born with a silver spoon in their mouth and they have those advantages like that. But that does not say that you cannot work hard to get there. But like you said, it's in your mind. Like, what is your mind telling you? Like, how are you really programmed? Like, I understand. And I think about the blueprint that was laid out for me ahead of time before I was created. That whole blueprint has to be worked out. But different distractions and different, you know, different things that happen that may put us back behind, you know, mm-hmm. just like, say you didn't grow up in the hood, where would you be now? What would you be doing now? But you think about it, the hood is what made you who you are. The yes. hood is what made you who you are. Because even though it wasn't a great situation, now what you've learned from back there in the hood, mm-hmm. now you could take that to help the other ones come out and change their mindset to be mm-hmm. a better version of themselves.
Mm-hmm. I mean, the hood is not a bad place. Again, in spiritual practice that I walk, we don't believe that you're born in any place on accident. Every place, any place you're born, any parent you're born to, you're supposed to be there, because they have, and that environment has something that you're going to need to fulfill your purpose, right? So if I'm born in somewhere in Brentwood or Beverly Hills, I would have never got to my messages that I'm supposed to get for me. So they had to send me there to go through that, to figure all that out. Later on in life, even two marriages later, after all of that situation, figure it out just to be able to come to this conclusion. And then, like you said, to be able to help other people. Mm-hmm. The hood is a message. That's my main thing, because I talk to kids all the time, and I'm talking like college graduates. They just got out of school, maybe 2-3 years. And you ask them one question: what is your purpose? They have no clue. And then I'm like, so you went to school 4 years. You paid all this money to go to school and you don't know what your purpose is. That means you got a degree for something you ain't supposed to do. You see how the software gets in your way and it starts blocking what you do naturally that's supposed to be for you. And we take on software that belong to other people.
Right. Yeah, like some parents live vicariously through their children.
Yeah.
And when they go to college, they say, now, this is what you going to school for. You going to school to be a doctor. You going to school to be a dentist. But
I don't even like that stuff.
I want to be an artist. Like, I can draw, you know. So now you just spent all this money to go over there for me to not be happy and for me to not to do that, because I'm still going to turn around and be an artist. So regardless, now that was a waste.
A waste of their money, though, because they didn't pay for it. At least.
Right, exactly. But yeah. You know what? I do believe that a part of your purpose, this is me talking from just talking to you. I do believe that there is a portion of you geared toward fatherhood and marriages. Like some of the lessons learned, you know, in marriage. It was just something that when you said that just kind of jumped out at me, because I could see that. I could see that, you know. Fathers have a hard time dealing with their children that get mixed up with the wrong crowd. Mm-hmm. So I think that's something to tap into, you know.
Yeah, I do that. I have a program of what in my works I call Prepare Straight.
Ooh.
Right. I help mentor kids. Fathers come to me all the time because sometimes, you know, I have two sons myself. When they get a certain age, they stop listening to their own father, technically. So you got to kind of let other people that you trust, obviously, step in and kind of share wisdom. It can be a coach. It can be, I had my son in karate. So karate, he paid attention to all that they had to say, right? But yeah, it's like I said, the hood is not bad. My experiences weren't bad. They were just lessons learned. And technically, to tell you the truth, I'm gonna tell you something I probably never shared online or anything yet, is that I said two marriages, right?
Yeah.
The second marriage broke me down to figure out I didn't have a clue of what a man was.
Wow.
Like I truly had a come to the Lord meeting with myself. And I sat on the floor and just cried for like an hour. I'm like, what is this? I didn't know what it was, literally. I really couldn't even put my finger on it. And and it went back to the concept of we talking about this hood, because in the hood, they teach you, you got to be tough all the time. You got to be on guard all the time. You got to be all of this. You got to get money. You got to do that. None of that is a man. That's a byproduct of what you're going to accomplish on planet Earth. That doesn't make you a man. A man is your character. The man is how you show up for your children and your wife, character-wise. The finances is going to be a byproduct of that. I didn't understand that. I didn't understand that, because when you see, look at the hood, anything hood, everything is chasing money. Everything is chasing females. Everything is chasing something outside of yourself. And you never look at yourself as, who am I? What do I want?
And all of that stuff is normalized there.
Exactly.
It's definitely normalized. And it's funny that you would say that, like I'm on my second marriage now. But my first husband, we get along great. And that's where all my children are. I have four. And he said, like everything that you're saying, he said, I was always raised that boys don't cry, that you got to be tough and this, that, and the other. And it don't help you to be able to emotionally care for your wife or even accept certain things. You got this hard exterior. So the soft side that she needs, it's almost like you lack that, you know? And then the other thing that he said was his brothers, like certain people that guided him when he was growing up just showed him the wrong way. He's seen his brothers womanizing. He's seen his brothers like hit women and stuff like that. So for him, that was normal. That was normal. It was normal. He didn't get this whole revelation until after COVID hit and he almost died. So he didn't get the revelation, but now he's completely healed and everything, but they had to put him under several times. But he got the revelation, but it's the conversations that you have with men to see where they are broken at, the traumas that they have gone through at the hands of other people to even help them to heal, to be a better man for their wives. It's hard. It's really hard.
I mean, you got to look at it like in the hood, there's no fathers really, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. And I'm not acting like fathers are the saving grace here, but they are a part of the equation. Because if you remove a father from the equation, you remove a part of that child's DNA that he will never know or she will never know who they are. Right. So for the most part, if you don't have a father, the mother doesn't see mothers lose validity in the mind of a young man around 14. 13, 14, he gonna start looking at you like, we the same size. I really don't care what you got to say. And you don't have that man in the house to roar and bark at him. He gonna look for it somewhere else. And usually it's outside. And outside, this tells you that you cannot be weak. Mm-hmm. What you crying for? Stop crying. Be quiet. Then what you crying for? You a punk. Like that concept gets pushed into your head. Even the mother pushes that into you because she doesn't want to see you get taken advantage of. So now she's feeding it. So now you grow up and you got to find a woman. And your mother done told you this. Everybody around you done told you this. But now this woman wants you to be a completely different person than what you've seen your whole life.
Right. Wow.
It doesn't make sense.
This is so interesting. I ain't gonna kid you. This could go so many different directions. This can really go so many different directions because when you start digging deep, you're pulling up the whole family dynamic and just breaking it apart and even looking at generational stuff.
Exactly.
Like what made them completely go to the hood? Most of the time, from my understanding, let me put it this way, from my understanding, most of the time, even when you look at people that's in the hood and in the projects, a lot of times it's because other family members have gone there and other families have lived there. Like, for instance, I'm from Cleveland, Ohio. I don't live in Cleveland now, but I'm from Cleveland, Ohio. But a lot of people that went to school with me that lived in the projects, the mother, after they became adults, the mother stayed on the end. The daughter was almost right next door to her and the granddaughter was next to her. So it's like the whole family right there in the projects right there together. Mm-hmm. Just went to fill out an application, but you didn't see what you really truly could have done on your own. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know. I lived in low income housing. And before I went, and I only went because of, we had lost our house. We lost our house. House went into foreclosure. And I didn't know what to do. I didn't want to live with nobody. So I filled out the application and they called me right away. And while I was picky, I'm going to go out there like, I ain't staying in this one. Now you're about to be homeless, but I'm going to be picky. But I'm like, forget that. My family still deserves more. And so the next place we got was one that was remodeled and it was a townhouse in a nice neighborhood. I said, oh yeah, this is it. But I went there with a 2-year plan and it makes a difference. Like you said, on your mindset, I went there with a 2-year plan, 2 years. We were out of there in 1 year and 9 months. I was not playing and had bought a house. So it's all about your mindset.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
how strong, how much do you want it? How do you really want it? You know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What do you want to share with me today? What else do you want to share? I'm gonna be quiet and I'm gonna let you talk. It's just everything that you say, I'm like, I can relate to that.
I'll just say it like this, that, like I said, PTSD affects every aspect of life. I look at this thing as five pillars, right? You have health, you have finances, you have relationships, you have children, and then you just have what we call overall victories in life that everybody wants to have, like goals and accomplishments, right? PTSD affects all of those things, everything. I'm a prime example of it. That's why I do. That's why I speak about it. That's why I created it. But it affects everything we touch. I'll just take health. If you look in the neighborhood, and we're talking health on all levels, not just your doctor's checkup, mental health, financial health, and relationship health. If you look at health in the community of any kind of ghetto, any ghetto in America, forget South Central. Just look at any ghetto from LA to Brooklyn. Right. Just look at any ghetto. Any ghetto you look in, the health is always the problem. Big mama got diabetes, high blood pressure. My mother died at 48 years old from high blood pressure and heart attacks. Okay. Now, the diet is not just the only thing. The stresses of the hood makes a sandwich out of this situation. So you got diet and you got stress. The hood is nothing but stress.
Yeah.
Right? Poverty, chasing the dollar, trying to struggle to survive, right?
Trying to keep from getting killed.
Keep from getting killed, all of that.
Right.
And then you add a negative diet to that. You're getting it from both sides, inside out. So at the end of the day, that's the hood. Chicken shops, hamburger stands, everything degenerate you can think of to eat, you got access in the hood, but you rarely even find a decent market within the perimeters of a hood.
Yep, because in the hood, you're going to find all of the hog jaws and all of, them, find all of that.
They don't sell that in the white folks.
Every other corner got a liquor store.
So, exactly. The liquor store. They got a pawn shop for you if you want to kill yourself faster. You can get guns from. They got everything in the neighborhood that's negative, right? So health-wise, financially is the same thing. Like your purpose, you're not supposed to ever, I don't ever believe in retiring, right? You can't retire from your purpose. This doesn't make sense to me, right?
You just go to at other levels and dimensions with it.
You get in the box doing through. Your purpose. Yeah,
right.
You get in the box doing your purpose. You retire from a job that you didn't want. But what's pushed to you in the neighborhood? A job you really don't want. They call it a good job. So I can go on and on, but the biggest one to me is relationships. Relationships, particularly romantic, husband and wife, heterosexual relationships are the ones that are really truly under attack, particularly now, but has always been under attack in the neighborhood because, again, how do we get to 70% of kids growing up without the other parent? Like, how do we get there? Somebody systematically attacked that, and this is the result that we get, the hood. Because when I grew up in LA, LA was a beautiful place. It was awesome in the 70s, 80s. The gangs created the drama that came in, and the gangs only came in when the businesses left the neighborhood.
Right.
And it impoverished the neighborhood. And then now the drugs came to replace the businesses that were there. Now you have this chaos going on in one place for 20, 30 years now. So it's like, it's so layered. It's so layered. I can go on forever, but it's so layered.
Listen, it was so much that came to my mind when you were talking, because especially when it came to relationships, on how the relationships are ruined by a lot of things that happen in the hood. Like one of them may end up on drugs and one of them may be like committing adultery. And so now you're splitting the family and all of this different kind of stuff is happening, different dynamics to break the family apart. So this is, you got a lot on your hands, but it's, you know what? But it's needed. That nonprofit organization that you're going to start is needed. That nonprofit organization is needed.
I hope I can say this on the air, but I'm going to say it anyway. I probably wouldn't do a nonprofit because I don't want the government in my business like that.
Well, you know what? I think they wouldn't have anything to do with it if you weren't a 501c3.
If you're not a 501c3?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So you could do it or for profit, nonprofit, or whatever. After taking that class on nonprofit organizational leadership, is some things I could really say. I probably wouldn't want 501c3.
That part right there. You see what I'm saying? Yeah. Yeah.
But when you, even when you look at a nonprofit, because it could be just a for profit that I'm seeing for you, but even when you look at that, there is so many different dynamics to it. Do you want to be the main one that's over it, or do you want a board that's going to dictate a lot of different things? So if you anything like me, I don't want nobody dictating my business. I don't mind having partners, but I don't want nobody dictating my business.
Yeah, me neither.
Now, I don't know if I'm wrong for that, but I'm just saying. See, because my thing is domestic violence and sexual assault.
Okay. So,
yeah.
Okay, yeah.
And teen moms, because I know that's big in the hood. It's teen motherhood.
Whew, that's a whole nother situation. That's a whole nother situation.
Save the teens. I actually did a book in November 2021, released a book, an anthology, and it's called I Did It, Teen Mom Parent Success. Yeah. I was a teen mom. I actually had 3 kids by the time I was 19.
Wow.
So I had the first one at 15, 2 weeks before I turned 16. And then I had the next one at 18 and the next one at 19. So.
I have a podcast called Heal PTHD. Mm-hmm. And I did an episode, because this is another hood thing to me too. I did an episode called The Bridal Shower Before the Baby Shower.
Oh, wow.
Right?
Do tell. I'm like, do tell.
Nowhere else in the hood, nowhere else besides the hood, is it's celebrated in this day and time that if your daughter or child comes home pregnant, the family comes together and throws her a bridal shower and she has no husband. Like, I have never seen it nowhere else. Like, you'll get more people having a bridal shower, a baby shower, way more than you have a bridal shower, right? And for me, if my daughter came home, she's not having a baby shower. I'm not celebrating this situation. I'm not doing that. I'm not helping you celebrate your, I'm not even say a baby is going to cause you, because a lot of people look at having a baby as a traumatic thing, or it's a bad thing about to happen to you, but it's not a bad thing. But you're putting you're having a child before you've even come into your own, and you can't give this child anything. You really can't. So, the concept to me, I remember when I first had my first son, I was 24 actually, and one of my guys I grew up with in LA, he came to the baby shower. He came over with his bottle of Hennessy, and was like, welcome to the club. I'm like, the hell are you talking about? He like, welcome to the club, like to the baby daddy club. I was like, what? Like, this is, I said, hold on, bro. Say that again. Like, But this mentality of like just being able to have a children and not have a husband or a wife or a spouse or a partner, like
stable household.
Stable household is that's some ghetto hood mess. They make songs about it, right? Mm-hmm. It's like, come on, man.
Mm-hmm. Yep. But you know what? When I became a teen mom, if it wasn't for my mother, my mother, she didn't work. She didn't work. But my dad has said she got enough to deal with y'all. She don't need to work, you know. And that's how he was. And if he needed to work two jobs, he did. Mm. But my dad made decent money. And so she took care of us. But what she told me when she found out that I was pregnant as a teen, mm-hmm. she said, all right, now you done did this. She said, you gonna finish school. You gonna make something out of yourself. And you gonna raise this baby. And I did just that. But let me tell you the stipulations. Do not turn to the left. Don't turn to the right. When you leave here and you go to school, you go straight to school. When you get out of school, you got a certain length of time to get here and get your package, you know? And but that's what she did. But the funny part of it is when I look at it, I was a teen mom. My mother was a teen mom. My sisters were teen mothers, right? It's generational. And so what I told my oldest daughter, it has to stop here. Mm-hmm. It has to stop here because my daughter was a teen mom. Mm. It has to stop somewhere. It has to stop. So me and her, we vowed to break that curse. It got to be broken. It has to be broken. There's no way around it. It has to be broken. It has to be. You know, because when you think about it, it ain't just by happenstance that it happened. It's not. It's a generational curse that's sent to, you know, to destroy stuff. Or because I probably could have been a doctor. Mm-hmm. With all of the intelligence and grades and all that kind of stuff, it's something that I could have. But like you said, what about that blueprint?
What about that purpose?
Yeah, there it is.
What about that purpose? And that's what we don't get taught. This transcends beyond hood, but at the same time, in the hood, again, there's no such conversation as what's your purpose.
Yeah.
No one asks you that.
Yeah. It's so many layers to be you know, you could just peel so many layers off from this. It's just like layer after layer after layer. I tell you. So I am going to slide out and I am going to let you give them some final words and some encouragement or whatever it is that you want to share. I'm sliding out. The floor is yours.
Slippity slide. Okay. Slide on out, Lakeside. Well, again, everyone, I'm thankful for this conversation. I'm thankful for being able to put this message out there in the universe. But what I want everybody to leave from this conversation is that if you are from the hood, if you were born in that mindset, there's somebody that's going to listen to this that has been thinking this in their mind for a long time, that the way they grew up is just not right. Even while you were there, you were probably the one who may be the black sheep of the environment. You may have been the Sharif. I call it Sharif, right? From Minister Society, the one who sat on the cooler while Kane and Old Dog was trying to get in the cooler to get a 40 ounce. Like, you may be that person. You may be the person that may be Kane and Old Dog is looking to change. But the only way that we can, either one of us can change, is to change the mindset. You cannot do anything without your mindset shifting. You cannot shift your mind totally if you don't change your environment. The people you hang around that comes from that environment, if you're in that poisonous environment, you're going to succumb to it to some degree. If you want to get out of it, and I pray that you do, because once you do, you will discover your purpose in this life. You will breathe new air. You will have a whole new outlook on life. And the only way that we can do that, or you can do that, is to shift your mindset. Remember this, the things you think about come from the programming in your mind. And the things that you think about becomes the words that you speak. Watch what you speak and then look up and look around you and see if what you're speaking resembles your words. If that is the case for you and you don't like what you see around you, let's start this thing from reverse. Let's start changing how we think. And what's around us influences what we think. Does that mean you got to move out of the hood? Preferably, yeah. I would say, yeah. But if maybe financially is not feasible for you, you can create your own oasis in your home. You can create your own oasis in your everyday life, even in the hood. You just have to be willing to walk away from people and things that no longer serve you. I have a thing I always say, you cannot take a canoe, or you should not take a canoe up the mountain where you just crossed the river with. You don't need it on the mountain. So whatever you've had dragging along this whole time through these woods, this big old canoe, and there's no water, it's time to let it go and drop it and get your butt to the top of that mountain so you can see a whole new plane. But we can't do it dragging old stuff behind us. So PTHD is something that I speak about, I am passionate about. I'm creating courses. I have a course that I'm currently creating right now. It's called Under the Hood, right? Under the Hood. We're going to get under the hood of your mind and start peeling back those layers. So look for that coming. But until then, you can always catch me at orene.com or powerofore.com for any kind of spiritual work or rework, mind, mental mindset, resets, all that type of stuff. I teach classes there too. But we got some under the hood work coming strictly for PTHDs and people like me, hood refugees like me, people that are trying to escape the hood mentality like me. I'm creating a website. I'm creating that curriculum called Under the Hood as we speak. It should be available in the next month or so. Thank you for listening to me and thank you for having me today. Doc.
Listen, I am going to slide you down and we're going to do this exit here. I'll pull you down for a second. Thank you all so much for joining us today on You Are Not Your Trauma. Remember, as Jasir said, you change your mind, you change your life. The words that you put out in the atmosphere, they have legs and they have ears. And they take off. So let everything that comes out of your mouth be positive. And let this mind that you have be renewed each and every day and be goal-oriented and be intentional. Be very much intentional. So again, this is Dr. Wendy Rhodes on the You Are Not Your Trauma Show. And we are done here today. So peace and blessings be unto you and your family.